Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our online service. I'm Pastor Jonathan Hatt of the Deer Island Churches of Christ, and again, we are so glad you're able to join with us as we worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords here today. Now, I just want to begin with a few announcements of what's going on with us. Tonight, July 19th, there is a drive-in gospel music fundraiser for the Charlotte County Christian Academy at the Seaview Full Gospel Church in Back Bay. And that's tonight at 6 p.m. and our very own Deer Island Churches of Christ worship team will be opening things up with a few songs. Also, Tuesday night is our weekly Bible study, and we're continuing on through the Gospel of John. And we have limited social distance seating in person for this, as well as we're going to continue using the Zoom meeting program online. Again, as I always say, we're asking that the in-person seating be reserved for those with limited, slow, or non-existent internet, and those with decent internet log in through Zoom at home. If you need any help with that, just message me and I can help you out. Wednesday, there's a couple things going on now. We're starting our Christian movie night back up. Now that's on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. at the Leonardville Sunday School building. Now, please let us know if you're planning on attending that so we can be sure that all the seating is socially distanced and spread apart. Also Wednesday night, we're going to continue on ringing the church bells at 7:30 for 10 minutes as a sign of solidarity and a call to prayer for all that's going on in the world today. Now remember, you can stay up to date with all that's going on with us on our Facebook page and be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. But before we continue on to worship and communion and the Word, let's go to the Lord in prayer together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to gather together, whether in person or online. And Lord, I pray that we wouldn't take that for granted. Lord, I pray that you would speak to us today and prepare our hearts to hear from you. But Lord, we know there are so many people that are going through major storms in their lives. God, I pray that you would heal those that have disease and sickness and illness, that you would heal and strengthen and restore, that you would work mightily. And Lord, I pray that you would let them know that they're not going through those issues alone, that you are there with them every step of the way, that they can rely on you and lean on you for help. God, I pray that you would be with all the frontline workers, doctors and nurses, everybody dealing with these situations. I pray that you would give them insight and wisdom and protect them. God, I thank you again that we can gather here in your name, and I pray that our worship would be pleasing to your ears and that your words would be heard and not mine. We thank you for all that you've done and all that you're doing, but Lord, we especially thank you for what you're going to do, and we look forward to it. In Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Those of you from Deer Island and those that have visited this place know that it is an extremely beautiful place. Now, we are surrounded by God's handiwork everywhere we look. Now, one thing that Deer Island has a lot of, if you've never been here, is deer. Amazingly enough, we have a ton of white-tailed deer all over the place over here. Probably too many. Now, there are a few that come out behind our house, and our dog Samson, Sanford Silas Hatt, as he's known, used to get excited and bark at these deer that would come behind the house, but they never seemed to really pay attention to him. So now he just lays on the deck and watches them and only barks when they go to leave and go back up into the woods. Now, over the last couple weeks, I have seen a lot of brand new baby fawns. Now, there are two tiny little ones behind our house, which looked to be only a few days old when I saw them first. And, you know, they had the bright white spots all over them. And the twins followed close to their mom as they explored the lawn and looking for things to munch on. And I watched them out back for a while. And the fawns were, you know, experiencing the world for the very first time. And one of them, of the twins, seemed to stay right by his mother's side, but the other twin wandered away a little bit and started to come down close to me on the back deck. Now, he was curious, but his mother quickly gave a little snort, and he turned around and ran back up to her. He was wandering away, and she gave him correction and guidance to get back to her. Now, Jesus will often do that in our lives as well. The moment that we're born again, the moment that we become a Christian, the moment we surrender our lives to Him, we begin to walk anew. We begin to learn what a life with Jesus is like. You know, we should constantly be growing in our faith, learning day by day to trust God more and more. But sometimes we get off track. Sometimes we get off the path that we're supposed to be on. We wander away from His safety, but He gives us gentle reminders to get us back to Him through His Word, through the leading of the Holy Spirit, through the help of others. The Bible says in John 14:26, "But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in My name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." Or maybe in your life, God wants to use you to help others that have wandered away, to shine His love through you, to speak life and help those around you through you. But that's only possible when we have a relationship with Jesus that is growing and alive daily. You know, the relationship, that guidance, that help is only possible because of the tremendous love that God has for us. A love so intense and so unconditional that He sent Jesus to the cross to bear our sins, to become sin in our place, to die in our place, so that we can be with Him in His protection, in His guidance, in His love. And never forget that. Never forget all that Jesus accomplished on the cross for you and for me. Never forget that willing sacrifice. That's why we meet around the communion table, to remember the cross and all that Jesus did for us. Now, at this time, I'm going to pray over these emblems and the emblems of yours at home. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank You that we can have communion with You, that we can reside with You, Lord, that You give us Your protection and Your guidance. Lord, I pray that we would never take that for granted, and I pray that we would never forget the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross, His broken body, His shed blood. Lord, I pray that You bless these emblems and the emblems of those at home that are watching. I pray that we would remember them and remember all that was accomplished for us and Your tremendous love. I pray that You bless them now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is My body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." And in the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of Me." For whenever you eat the bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. beautiful sight. It's a beautiful, beautiful sight. Carry me through the waters where your peace clears away all my sorrow. Nothing
I
Just after high school graduation, I continued to help my father-in-law with youth group that he was leading and helping with games and playing drums and guitar and that kind of thing, just being a helper. But one day during lobster fishing season, he called me and said that he wasn't going to be in from fishing in time for youth group and asked if I could have the lesson. Now, I was petrified, but I did say yes. I wasn't sure exactly what to talk with to the teens, and after a lot of prayer and searching, I decided to talk about one of my favorite Bible characters, one that I identify with a lot, and that was Gideon. Now, I spoke about Gideon, and I told them about him and what we can learn from him at youth group that night, and I think it went okay. You know, nobody got up and walked out on me, and it was the very beginning, the very start of my speaking ministry, and I've always looked back on that one message with a smile. Now, I'm not going to read the entire story of Gideon from Judges 6 and 7, if you want to turn with me there now, but I'm going to paraphrase the whole story for you, if you don't already know it. Now, the story of Gideon starts out by proclaiming that the Lord was angry with the Israelites for falling into sin again, and worshiping false gods and idols. Now, because of this, the Lord let them fall into the hands of the destructive Midianites for 7 years. Finally, fed up, the Israelites called out to God for help, and God would send aid through a man named Gideon. Now, Gideon was just a small young man who was threshing wheat in a wine press because he was a coward and afraid of the Midianites and them stealing his wheat. So he's there, and an angel of the Lord appears to Gideon and says, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." You know, he wasn't acting like a mighty warrior, but that's what he said. And the angel then proceeded to tell Gideon that he will deliver the Israelites from the Midianites, to which point Gideon says that he is just a small young man. Gideon then asks the angel for a sign to prove that he really is speaking with God and leaves and returns with an offering of food. The angel then spontaneously combusts the food, and Gideon realizes that it truly is an angel of the Lord. That same night, the Lord tells Gideon to destroy one of his father's altars, which was to Baal, and replace it with an altar to God and sacrifice a bull on it. Gideon does so, but he does it at night so that nobody will notice and he's not caught. The townspeople find out Gideon did this and demand his execution, but Gideon's father, Joash, however, explained that if Baal truly was God, he would be able to defend himself. So Gideon then gives a call to arms to fight against the Midianites, and several other groups join him. Then Gideon asks for another sign from God that it is him that is going before them. He asks God to make the fleece the only wet thing on the ground the next morning, and then the only dry thing on the ground the morning after that. God does both of these, and Gideon knows that God is actually with him. So in the morning, the Lord tells Gideon he must cut down the size of his army, otherwise the Israelites won't contribute their win over the Midianites to God, but rather they would think that they did it themselves. So 32,000 men had gathered to fight with Gideon. Now Gideon achieved this by saying, "Any person who is too scared to be here, you can go home." Well, 22,000 men get up and leave, and only 10,000 remain. However, God said there's still too many men. So he tells Gideon to go down to the river to see how the men drink. So God instructs Gideon to only keep the men who use their hands to drink water and put it to their mouths, rather than putting their head right down to the river to drink. So he does that. And the army size that's left is just 300 soldiers. So that night, with his 300, God instructs Gideon before battle to go down to the valley where the giant Midianite army is and where they're camping to see what the Midianites are dreaming of. Now, this was meant to relax and assure Gideon again that God was on his side. So in the valley, Gideon overhears a conversation between two Midianites in which one Midianite says to the other that he had a dream where a loaf of bread tumbled down into the camp and slammed into their tent. And the other Midianite interprets this and says, "The sword of Gideon is going to lay wrath upon us." So Gideon hears this dream and interpretation, and he is encouraged and goes back and decides that they are going to now start invading. Gideon tells his people to split up into three groups of 100. Gideon then gives everyone trumpets with jars and torches in them. And after marching to the Midianite camp up on the top of the hills, everyone blows their trumpets and breaks their jars. Then they stood there repeating, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon." The huge Midianite army wakes up and is very confused and, thinking they're under attack, start fighting. However, they're actually fighting themselves and decimate their own army. Gideon has the victory without his soldiers even lifting their swords. Gideon sends messages to the other Israelites about the Midianites and what happens. So the other Israelites capture the Midianites and all their leaders that are left. Okay, so there's a lot going on in that story. That's basically Gideon in a nutshell. But that, of course, was the Cole's Notes version. But this morning I want to pick this story apart a little bit and see what it means for us today, and how we can learn from this awesome story of Gideon, and how it isn't much different than from what many of us are facing even now today. So the first thing that we can learn from Gideon and apply to our own lives today is that God sees you for who you really are. God sees you for who you really are. Look at Judges chapter 6, verses 11 and 12 with me. And it says, "The angel of the Lord came and sat down under the oak in Ophrah that belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, where his son Gideon was threshing wheat in a winepress to keep it from the Midianites. When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, 'Lord, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior.'" So again, Gideon is threshing wheat in a winepress, which was solely because he was scared. You know, he didn't think he could stand up to the Midianites. They were bullies. He thought the Israelites were defeated. He didn't see any way out for them. He had given into the situation, relenting that they would be overrun by them. He was small and he was scared, but God didn't view Gideon like that. God viewed him as a mighty warrior, one who was strong and courageous and could take on anyone. You know, he thought he was one that could lead the army. He saw him as one who could command charge among his people, a warrior. A leader. Gideon saw himself as a small and insignificant, but God saw Gideon for who he really was deep down. Now, I see this kind of thing all the time at summer camp. I dean summer camps and where we have tons of fun playing games and eating great food and learning about the Lord. You know, we have kids from all over the place that come for a fun week of camp. But kids from every background there is. And I remember a few years ago, there was a young man from a maritime city that had a very rough life. His home life was really bad. He had been seen at school from his peers as a write-off and an outcast, and he fell into that role. You know, but I saw tremendous potential in this young guy. For that week of camp, the staff and I at Bayview treated him differently than everyone else did at school, and his parents, you know, gave him responsibility and love and put him in charge of small things like helping lead games or helping his cabin win points. You know, you could literally see the change over the course of that week in his life. You know, we saw him for who he really was rather than how everyone else saw him or even how he saw himself. You know, in our daily Christian walk, sometimes we look at ourselves as weak. We look at the situation around us that is defeating us and think that's just where we're supposed to be. We resign ourselves to think this is as good as it gets. But God sees you differently than that. He sees you for who you really are and what you can really do. He sees the potential that he's placed inside of you. He sees you for the powerful Christian that you are deep down. And one that shows his love to the world around you. One that is a prayer warrior when situations seem desperate. One that shines the light of Christ into the darkness of the world and trusts God with every aspect of their life. God sees you for who you really are, not as the world sees you or how you see yourself. So firstly, we learn from Gideon that God sees us for who we really are. And secondly, God helps us through our insecurities. God helps us through our insecurities. Look at verses 17 and then 36 to 40 of chapter 6. Verse 17, "Gideon replied, If now I have found favor in your eyes, give me a sign that it is really you talking to me. Then down to verse 36, Gideon said to God, if you will save Israel by my hand, as you have promised, look, I will place a wool fleece on the threshing floor. If there is dew only on the fleece and all the ground is dry, then I will know that you will save Israel by my hand, as you said. And that is what happened. Gideon rose early the next day. He squeezed the fleece and wrung up the dew, a bowl full of water. Then Gideon said to God, don't be angry with me. Let me make just one more request. Allow me one more test with the fleece, but this time make the fleece dry and the ground be covered with dew. That night God did so. Only the fleece was dry. All the ground was covered with dew. So, Gideon was still scared even after the angel told him what was going to happen, even though God called him a mighty warrior. He was begging and beginning to trust God more and more, kind of. But, God didn't give up on him. He let Gideon test him three times and work through those insecurities into a place where he eventually began trusting God wholeheartedly. Gideon was slowly realizing God was in control, that he was realizing God was up to something big in his life and for the Israelites. But Gideon didn't really jump in with both feet immediately. He still had lots of insecurities about himself and about the power of the Midianites. So God was patient with him. Step by step, he helped Gideon get to where he needed to be. He helped him through his insecurities. Now, I used to be really insecure about my drum playing abilities. Not that I'm very good now, but I was self-taught. And there was things about drumming that I don't know. And when I first went to Bible school, there were some incredible drummers there. Guys that had been doing it their whole lives. Now, I didn't start drumming till I was 18, but I kept working at it and praying about it. Then years later, my brother-in-law started a band, and I begged him to let me join, and he had to because he married my sister. So we were there, and we were touring around a bunch and doing shows, and it was great. But I remember feeling really insecure about a lot of the concerts that we did and even at our practices. Not because anyone ever said anything, but I was surrounded by these phenomenal musicians, and there was just little old me. But I would pray, and I would pray a lot each and every time, and eventually those insecurities would subside, and we would have an amazing time sharing the gospel through our music. Now, in our lives, God wants us to trust him without any reservations. He wants us to believe that he says and trust the urging of the Holy Spirit whenever he speaks, to trust what he says. But that may not have always been the case right away in our lives. I know it hasn't been the case in my life. Your faith will grow and build after every time we have God use us or work through us. But sometimes we need help working through those insecurities when we don't feel good enough or equipped enough or worthy enough. God will help you through that. God hasn't brought you this far to leave you. He has a plan for your life. He has a direction for you. We need to continue to work through those insecurities day by day, drawing closer to him and trusting him more and more. Not being comfortable with where we are or even regressing, but pushing through those shortfalls and those insecurities. And God will help with that. But we have to trust him. So, firstly, we learn from Gideon that God sees you for who you really are. And secondly, he'll help you through your insecurities. And thirdly, God will increase your confidence. God will increase your confidence. Look at chapter 6, verse 27, and then chapter 7, 17 to 25. And it says, so Gideon took 10 of his servants and did as the Lord told him. But because he was afraid of his family and the townspeople, he did it at night rather than in the daytime. Then over to chapter 7, verse 17. Watch me, he told them. Follow my lead. When I get to the edge of the camp, do exactly as I do. When I and all who are with me blow our trumpets, then from all around the camp blow yours and shout, for the Lord and for Gideon. Gideon and the 100 men with him reached the edge of the camp at the beginning of the middle watch, just after they had changed the guard. They blew their trumpets and broke the jars that were in their hands. The three companies blew the trumpets and smashed the jars, grasping the torches in their left hands and holding in their right hands the trumpets that they were to blow. They shouted, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon." While each man held his position around the camp, all the Midianites ran crying out as they fled. When the 300 trumpets sounded, the Lord caused the men throughout the camp to turn on each other with their swords. The army fled to Bethshitta towards Zerah, as far as the border of Abel Meholah near Tabath. Israelites from Naphtali, Asher, and all of Manasseh were called out, and they pursued the Midianites. And Gideon sent messengers throughout the hill country to Ephraim, saying, "Come down against the Midianites and seize the waters of the Jordan ahead of them as far as Beth-barah." So all the men of Ephraim were called out, and they seized the waters of the Jordan as far as Beth-barah. They also captured the two of the Midianite leaders, Oreb and Zeb. They killed Oreb at the Rock of Oreb and Zeb at the winepress of Zeb. They pursued the Midianites and brought the heads of Oreb and Zeb to Gideon, who was by the Jordan. So, there's a huge, big difference when Gideon started this journey, when he was a scared guy who was petrified of the Midianites who were going to steal his wheat, you know, resigned to the place of being overrun with them, complacent with the situation, but he changed. His step of faith was to tear down the false idols in his hometown, but he did it at night because he was scared, but he did it. Then we see at the end of chapter 7, he is exactly, finally, what God said that he would be in the first place, a mighty warrior in charge of an army. You know, his confidence grew throughout his service to God, and he became a great man of God. Now, I remember the first sermon that I ever preached in front of a church. Pastor Cook in Back Bay, probably in, I think, 2005, asked if I would preach one Sunday night, and we were in Bible school at the time, and I reluctantly said yes. One of my professors in college told us to never turn down an opportunity to talk about the Lord. So I agreed to preach. Now, I was petrified. I contemplated backing out a million times. I worked a lot on the message, and I finally finished with 12-page, size 10 font, single-space sermon on something I can't even remember what it was. But I do remember getting up to speak after the worship team had done their thing, and I put my pages down, and I held onto the pulpit, and I started just reading. I read fast. I don't think I looked up once. I just kept going, and I flew through those pages like they were on fire. I think it took me like 7 minutes to get through the whole sermon, and I finished with, that's it. And I quickly went and sat down. Now, graciously, Pastor Cook got up and used something of what I said and smoothed things down at the end of the service and used that to close things out. You know, my fly was down the whole time that I preached my first sermon, and my white shirt was out through. Great first sermon, I know. But it was a step, and I did it. You know, I gained more and more confidence, and as time went on, all through God's help, I was able to do it easier and easier. Now, I promise you that the more you do for God and His church, and the more you step out in faith, the more confident you will become in your faith. The more you step out in faith for Him, the more He will bless you with victory and with that confidence. You know, you will realize that God was right about you all along. You are a mighty warrior. You know, He will begin to transform you. He will use you to change the world around you. He will show people His love and His salvation plan through you. You know, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You may not see it in your life yet, but it's coming. So in closing, the reason that Gideon is one of my favorite characters in the Bible is because it shows me that God can use just a regular, average person to achieve greatness through them. I mean, look at the disciples, virtually a band of nobodies when it came to the religious people of that time. But He changed the world through them, changes that we still see today. God wants to use you as well, but you need to trust Him. Trust Him and realize that you are who He says that you are. Now, if you're listening this morning and you've never taken that step to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to encourage you right now to do so. It is by far the greatest decision you can ever make in your entire life. Contact me or another believer that you know that can help. You will not regret it. But if you're like me and you've been serving God for a while, sometimes we can feel like Gideon at the first part of this story. We feel, you know, overwhelmed by the situations we find ourselves in. But don't be complacent. Strive to follow God's plan for your life. See yourself for who you really are. Work through those insecurities with God's help. And allow faith and confidence in Christ to grow. Trust God more and more every single day with every aspect of your life. And never forget that God loves you.